In just 1 week, we'll see the release of Us Kids, a new documentary that charts the rise of the March for Our Lives movement. It's going to be premiering both on demand and in theaters. And we are very lucky to have the opportunity to talk to two of the stars of the documentary. We're joined now by Cameron Kasky and Alex King. Welcome to both of you. Thank you for joining us today.
How's it going?
So it's been a couple of years that are being sort of summed up and contextualized in this documentary. I honestly can't even imagine, and people generally just say that casually, but I've tried. I can't imagine what this time has been like. But I imagine that the impending release of the documentary is probably, you know, providing you with the opportunity to do a bit of a look back on where you've come, what the current state of the movement is. What are your thoughts on the release of this documentary? Why don't we start with you, Cameron?
Sure. I feel it's really frustrating. People get really mad at me when I say that I feel old. They say, "Cameron, you're 20. You're a baby. You can't complain about that." But you know what? Everybody, you know, relative to their own life experiences, can feel old sometimes. And when people talk about how it's been 3 years, and now, you know, it's just gone by so fast. I feel like an old dude. But you know, it's a very different country now. It's a very different media landscape, right? The documentary Us Kids is really about the media circus after the Parkland shooting, and then what we were able to do after that, and how we were able to take that momentum and what we wanted to do with it, what kind of changes we wanted to make in the way that the country talked about mass shootings. And it was a different country. 2018 and 2021 are different in ways we could have never expected. Yeah. So the way that the conversations around mass shootings continue on, especially with Biden as president and seeing how the media is going to adjust with that kind of thing, it really is bizarre. And I hate to say it, because again, I'm 20, but I feel like an old man.
Alex, what about you? Are you feeling prematurely aged today?
Yes, I'm in the same boat as Cam. and not just feel older, you know, you see, I got the beard going on. I kind of look it too. but I totally agree with Cam. Like the world that we're living in now, 2021, is totally different from 2018 when all of this began. And it gets crazy because I get asked all the time, what are you doing now? What's next? What's going on? It's like, hey, I'm still trying to figure out life for myself, you know? I still want to be a kid. I still want to be an adult. I'm having conflictions. It's day to day, but I see that I had to grow up fast. I had to grow up faster than some of my peers and everything. But yeah, I still want to enjoy my days as the youth, because you only have so many days before you can call yourself young again.
Exactly. And then a bit more time passes and you can't even remember that part of your life. I remember 28, kind of. That's where I cap out, actually. But anyway, let me ask you a question, Alex, because it's this period of 3 years. As both of you are saying, there's this sort of like media furor, and become national figures. And a lot has happened since then. I mean, obviously last year was the longest year in quite a long time. So it seems to me that this documentary, we hopefully get a lot of people to watch it. It'll remind them of this movement, because obviously there's a lot of things that are on people's minds. And I've been a little bit worried recently by some of the more recent polls I've seen showing that the public support for gun control measures had spiked and was pretty consistent for a few years. Now it seems like it's inching down. Maybe people are like prioritizing it less. So Alex, if people watch this, what are you hoping that they will sort of take away from this documentary?
What I want people to take away from this documentary is that it's okay to go through things, but what we have to do is get through them. It's okay to be the first one to take a step forward. As you will see in this documentary, it's a bunch of kids, as we were called, taking a stand, going against so much, going against gun violence, going against a corrupt government, going against everything. But as you can see, we took the stand. Being 18, 19, some of us younger than that, holding conversations with people that are for gun rights, Second Amendment of those natures. I'm sorry, I'm getting lost in my train of thought.
No worries at all.
But it's just things like that, and I want you to know that even in this documentary, when times get serious, we still laugh, we still have our joking moments. So I want people to take away that too. Everything in life isn't serious.
Yeah.
Take your time when you need it to take a step back and think about yourself, because self-care is very important.
I agree. Cameron, what are your thoughts? What do you want people to take away from the documentary?
Well, it's really weird because this documentary was made at a time where being somebody who's out there advocating for stronger gun laws and being somebody who is demanding gun control was a lot easier. And it's definitely not a popular opinion, but right now being a gun control advocate is a bit more difficult than it was under the Trump presidency. Because right now, when you're demanding stronger gun laws, the media is going to say, guys, President Biden is doing everything he can. And no matter what happened when Trump was president, you know, if anything's going on in the gun violence prevention world, if it's something the Democrats can use to campaign against Trump, obviously everybody's behind you. But now that Biden's president, and look, Biden's, you know, enacting measures that absolutely should have been enacted, and the laws that he's passing are necessary. But when the gun violence prevention community comes out and says, this is not enough, you're not actually, forget what needs to be done, you're not even delivering your campaign promises, suddenly you are not part of the team and you are being problematic and an annoying little Gen Zer, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can definitely see that. Like, you were lauded for speaking truth to power, but wait, now someone we kind of like is in power. You're being inconvenient in a way that's inconvenient to us, not just to, you know, potentially Mitch McConnell or Marco Rubio or something like that. So I like, how do you respond to that? How do you get people who might be either like, they're very ready to be a bit more apathetic? We've been through that dark time. Don't make me pay attention every day. Or that would say, come on, guys, give Biden a chance, give him 3 months or 2 years or two terms or whatever. How do you get through to them that it's sort of our moral imperative to be just as fired up about doing something about this now as we were then, especially because nothing has been done yet? There hasn't been any big action. Like, there was no currency to buy faith. He hasn't done anything crazy big yet. So how do you get people to feel that same sense of urgency?
Well, that's why the most frustrating thing about this was that this isn't just some pie in the sky list of demands we made. A lot of the things people are calling for the Biden administration to do are from both Joe and Kamala Harris's plans. They mm-hmm. campaigned on all of these issues, and they campaigned obviously on tons of things that they were able to deliver and tons of things that they weren't. But suddenly, you know, when you start to bring it up, people get so frustrated. So unfortunately, we've only got what, a year and a half left before the midterms, when suddenly, if and in the likely situation the Republicans take a lot from us, everybody then gets to say, see, look, Biden only had 2 years to get the guns done. And then the Republicans, they came back in. It's cyclical, you know. It's after Sandy Hook, when the Sandy Hook shooting happened, and we hadn't gotten any substantial gun laws since, I think that was kind of indicative that this is gonna be the same pattern. We'll get a couple extra technocratic measures every couple of years. Oh, we'll get the red flag laws and we'll get the, and that's all terrific. But mm-hmm. you know, don't campaign on it if you're not gonna do it. Sorry to sound like the broken record of American politics, you know, somebody just throwing platitudes out there, but really mm-hmm. like, this was part of their whole plan.
Yeah. And Alex, you know, some of the defenders of Biden might say, well, look, there's tons of things that Biden would like to do, but he's got the Republicans. And oh, also there's Sinema and Manchin, and they're not always going to play ball. So we really need to pump the brakes a bit, see what we can get done in a bipartisan fashion. What are your hopes? Or like, do you have any hopes that some Republicans might sign on to literally any kind of gun control? Or do you believe that the Democrats should not waste that time and just go it alone and see what they can get done?
No, I honestly do hope some Republicans do sign on, because we can't mm-hmm. just win this fight by ourselves. And I hope that we get to that point where we can have each other's backs, where we can feel that it can get to Democrats and Republicans helping each other and not this so one-sided. No, I'm a Democrat, I'm a Republican, I'm choosing Biden, I'm choosing this person. What I want to do is pick off each other, use each other's resources, because both sides have good points. So why not bring all good points together and make one plan? We need to unite. That's the only way we're going to do. We're going to create real change. We need to unite.
Okay. And for both of you, you know, Biden has mentioned gun control. He did in his congressional address not long ago. As you've both pointed out, it's been in his plans. It's been in the vice president's plans. There are these things they say they're going to do. Is there anything in particular that you'd like to have them prioritize? Some first measure, if it's, you know, if it's background checks, or if it's taking up assault weapons, or if it's magazine limitations, what would you like to see prioritized if and when the Democrats do actually get around to this?
Well, I feel like this is at this point a cop-out answer, just because of how obvious it is. It's not creative or, you know, particularly sharp to say this, but abolish the filibuster. You abolish the filibuster, a lot of these measures we need to get past have a real fighting chance. But despite the fact that we've got every serious individual in Democratic leadership addressing that the filibuster needs to go, no, we've got to you know, we'll deal with it later. We'll figure it out, everyone. Don't worry about it. Give us a couple more years.
A couple more. Alex, any priority for you?
My priority is the community. We need to resource our communities. A lot of the time, a lot of gun violence spikes in poor and poverty-tized neighborhoods. And a lot of this can stop is if we just give our communities what we're looking for: affordable jobs, affordable homes, things of that nature. I feel like we'll bring this gun violence itself down a lot more.
Yeah. You know, Alex, I really appreciate what you said about one of the things that's gonna be revealed in the documentary is that and it shouldn't need to be reminded of people, but like while you are doing serious work and you're taking on serious challenges, you're not all 100% serious all the time, nor should you be expected to be. And so to both of you, after 3 years of being in the thick of this and fighting so many battles against so many opponents and all of that, are there any other misconceptions about your work or the movement that you'd hope someone who is paying attention to this debate could be corrected on? First to you, Alex.
I would like for people to understand that this work chose me, and I chose it. A lot of people, I got bashed a lot about this, like being told that I was a crisis actor, being told that I was a pawn, being told that I was just used for the color of my skin. And I just want to shed a light and let people know that I've been doing this line of work. I've been an activist since high school, since before 2018, since around 2014. With Peace Warriors, that's another organization inside of my high school, North Lundale College Prep, the school that I graduated from. And that I just want people to really get to understand, like, this is a life work. I lost family by the hand of guns. I've lost friends, many. But that's not gonna stop me. It's only gonna make me go 10 times harder to create change. Even if I'm not here to see it, I have younger siblings. I have two little sisters that I don't want her to grow up in the world that I had to grow up to. So I'm gonna continue to fight, and I want and I hope that people are gonna continue to fight with me, with us.
Okay, and Cameron?
I would say that, you know, people in this country, especially with guns, are obviously very reactionary, and they're very quick to pick up and drop an issue. But, you know, behind the scenes and beyond just what everybody sees, there have been people organizing to stop gun violence in ways that are only really coming into the conversation now. You know, community programs that promote peace were only things that I had been seeing widely discussed last year during the protests. And look, it's great that the word was getting out, but these organizations have been around all along. And ending gun violence, like Alex says, discussing communities, really does start in so many different areas. I never like to look at gun violence as a monolithic issue the way some people do. I think a lot of Americans don't look at gun violence as a monolithic issue. It's a racial justice issue. It's a policing issue. It's a public health issue. It's a healthcare issue. It's so thematic of so many different problems that are rooted in the country that you have to take a wide approach to ending it. You know, there are bans that need to be put in place. There are serious measures that need to be put in place to control these weapons. They are far too dangerous. People have time and again used them in acts of violence that were premeditated. There's so many different things that can be done, but especially with the administration we have right now, it's important to remember that there's so many different things that factor into this, and hitting it kind of from one policy end isn't going to do much to end the violence. So when we had the assault weapons conference, we talk about how that didn't drive down gun violence, that didn't drive down murders, and you know, especially with crime and policing, the bills getting passed in the 90s weren't going to be stopping gun violence. They were only going to be making it worse. So, you know, we have to attack this from all ends. And with what we're seeing right now, it's going to take a very different administration to do it.
Sure. I think that's important context. The documentary Is Us Kids coming out on the 14th. Everyone, you know, if movie theaters are playing films in your areas, it's available in theaters. If not, it is available on demand. So I hope that as many people as possible watching this will tune in. But I want to thank both of you, Cameron and Alex, for taking time out of your schedule to join us. Really do appreciate it.
Thanks for having us.
For more political news breakdowns, interviews, stories of activism, and me trying my hardest to care about the occasional big celebrity news story, subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/thedamagereport. And you can ring the bell wherever it is so you don't miss anything.